Our very crime of sufferings to move you to watching notes, meaning that, you know, prayer itself starts the journey out of the depths. Prayer is sort of start another measure of that journey. We have an England saying, which is a very secular saying, it is, when you're in a hole, stop digging. The message of this psalm is, when you're in a hole, start praying. And who you pray with will be very, very important. I never thought in a million years I would be praying in prison with a whole lot of bank robbers and murderers, who says who. But that's actually what happened to me. One of the things I expect to advise all of you to think about is, if you can ever get into a small group of people who pray together, that is a wonderful thing to do. You're sometimes with the most improbable companions, as it was when I was in jail. I had my small prayer group that started up. I did have a bank robber, a safe girl, a guy who forged bank notes, a couple of murderers. It gave a new meaning to the Christian term of soul of this group, and as we studied the prayer together. But it's a wonderful thing to do, to get into a group and to pray, and to pray for your debts. The second stanza, a couple of verses in the psalm, are really all about forgiveness and penitence. And they go, if you, O Lord, kept a record of our sins, O Lord, you could stand, but with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared. The great Baptist 19th century preacher C.H. Spurgeon, he commented on the psalm. He said that these verses contain the essence of the scripture, and in a way he was right, because when you're in the depths and you start to pray, probably one of the first things you start to think about is your own sins and being penitent about them. And we quickly discover from the psalm, of course, elsewhere in scripture as well, that we have a wonderful God who is above all a forgiving God, who does not keep a record of our sins. Paul reminds all of sin, all of them are called short of the glory of God, but this is God who is willing to forgive us. And just as that all sounds so reassuring and comforting, the psalmist perhaps a rather sharp little punch into the last line. He says, but with you there is forgiveness, therefore we are feared. Now, I know this is not true of the BC Linter School, but there is a sort of world out there of what might be called soft soap, soft cell of religion. And you won't get many preachers in that category ever talking about the fear of God, because that's a sort of difficult, sort of unmentionable subject. And yet it's there in the heart of Scripture time and again that we should fear God. Fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, says the book of Proverbs. And right through the Old Testament, the fear of the Lord is very real to those who believed in him in those days. And somehow it's sort of been airbrushed out of it in the 21st century. And this psalm brings it back. And it's just worth looking at. Why does the psalmist here link forgiveness and fearing God? What does fear really mean? Fear does not mean a sort of terror, a dread, some servile, cringing anxiety. It means, I think, above all, respect. Wonderful Christian writer John Stott gets it right as well as anybody when he writes this verse, that fear and love are the inseparable elements of true religion. Fear preserves love from degenerating into presumptuous familiarity. Love prevents fear from becoming a servile and cringing dread. And so I think John Stott, one of the great theologians of our age, fits the nail on the head there. We need to respect God and to love and the kind of respect we accord to nobody else. So is that sort of special respect? And sometimes my imagination wonder what would happen if into this chapel right now and in the woman, somebody we hugely respect in the secular world came in, President of the United States, or let's think of some historical figure. Abraham Lincoln, Winston Churchill, William Shakespeare. Shakespeare, suddenly named Terry, what would we do? We'd be all stand up. Sure, we'd all be very, very respectful. But if Jesus Christ came in, our Lord came in, I think we'd do something very, very different, which is we would kneel. We would kneel because he is the God of forgiveness, God of healing, God of spiritually changes, and he's in a different category. And that's why this word respect isn't good enough. The other person, the word fear, maybe is.